So we're going to talk about ticks and tick-borne diseases, but an alternative title would be Fighting the Bite. It's not just Lyme disease anymore. So what I'm going to do today is kind of give you an overview of the emerging issue of tick-borne diseases. I'm going to talk about the spread, geographic spread and increase in tick abundance. It's not just our deer tick and Lyme anymore. And then talk about how you, prevention measures and some of the research that's been done on trying to basically handle this somewhat very intractable problem. Now, I think gathered most of you are familiar with the experiment station. We're based in New Haven. That's where our main labs are. We're the first agricultural experiment station in the United States. And consequently, unlike all the others across the country, we're not part of the land-grant university system. We are a separate state agency. We have a research laboratory in Windsor, out in Griswold, and of course we have a 75-acre research farm there in Hamden. And every August we have a big open house. It's called Plant Science Days. Anybody here ever been to our Plant Science Day? Great. Okay, so it's almost always the first Wednesday in August, but next year actually it'll be the second Wednesday in August, the 8th rather than the 1st. One of the rare exceptions to that. Before I get into the real topic today, I just, instead of putting it at the end, I just want to introduce the tick team, as I call it here at the experiment station. Dr. Gudaj Miller runs the tick testing laboratory, so he's the one that oversees actually all the testing of the ticks that people send in. Heidi, Megan, and Michael Short are technicians that work for us. Dr. Scott Williams is a wildlife biologist on the team, and Dr. Eliza Little is a postdoctoral scientist, just finishing up her PhD actually, and is good at modeling and statistical analysis and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, that's our tick team. So when you think about tick-borne diseases, I'll start off with this quote, okay? Few agricultural or health problems confronting human societies have proved as intractable as the control of ticks and the many diseases they transmit. Tick control has been and is heavily dependent on chemical toxicants in terms of carcinogens, and we'll be looking at some alternatives to spraying for ticks, although that's still an important element in managing ticks, particularly on livestock or pets. Worldwide, we have a lot of tick-associated diseases of humans. I'm not going to really get into these, but if you're traveling overseas, just bear in mind, if you pick up an exotic tick, you've got a really good chance of picking up an exotic disease, like African tick bite fever, Mediterranean spotted fever, tick-borne encephalitis, and so on and so forth. So, just something to bear in mind. It's not just the U.S., which is where we're going to be focusing on. But I also want to give a little bit of history here, okay? So the actual first transmission of a disease pathogen by an arthropod vector was with ticks. And that's when Theobald Smith and Fred Kilburn proved in 1893 that Texas cattle fever, which was causing huge losses in cattle, it's a Babesia protozoan organism, was caused by this organism, and that led to the whole program of massive control of the tick. And so today, the tropical ticks that transmit cattle fever is down in Mexico, and there's a narrow quarantine ban right around the Texas border, but it's been largely eliminated from the United States. In the late 1800s, Rocky Mountain spotted fever was first identified from human cases. There were very virulent cases in the Bitterroot Valley of Montana, and that's how it's got its name, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, although most cases actually occur in the eastern part of the United States. And then actually, because of the tick-borne encephalitis, DDT was actually used in Russia for very large-scale sprayings to try to control Ixodes persicatus, which is related to our black-legged tick here. It's the one that transmits Lyme in Asia and Russia. So that was a massive control effort, but fortunately there is a vaccine available for that today. So as we look at the history of tick-borne pathogens as causes of human diseases here, I just mentioned Rocky Mountain spotted fever, then we had tularemia, and then tick-borne relapsing fever, and there's several different borrelia that cause tick-borne relapsing fever. These are transmitted by soft ticks out west, Colorado tick fever, and then Powassan virus was actually recognized in Powassan, Ontario back in 1958 when a child died from it. And as we progress, Babesia microti that causes babesiosis was discovered. You all know, and then Lyme disease. Some various different species that caused ehrlichiosis and anaplasma. And now we got a whole bunch of new ones. Heartland virus, we got a new Lyme disease pathogen, Borrelia mayenii, Borrelia miyamotoi, which is actually somewhat related to the Borrelia that cause relapsing fever out west. So we've got this cascade. We keep finding new diseases. One that's not on here is the bourbon virus. And it's not, it has anything to do with the drink. It's because there was a man that died from this virus in Bourbon County, Kansas. You know, so the diseases are usually named after some geographic location. That's why Lyme and so forth. Ebola was actually like the Ebola River is where it got its name. A lot of diseases are named as a consequence of that. So what we have in the U.S. today is we have probably somewhere around 20 human diseases, and I'm not even talking about those specific to livestock here. So this is the list of the major ones: anaplasmosis, babesiosis, Lyme, miyamotoi, mayenii, which is a new one, the bourbon virus, cholera tick fever, ehrlichiosis, Heartland virus, southern tick associated rash illness, your various spotted group, rickettsia, Rocky Mountain spotted fever is the main, most important one, but there's a few others too. The various pathogens that cause tick-borne relapsing fever, Powassan virus, tularemia, and so on. The list goes on. Tick paralysis, which is actually a toxin, not a pathogen. So there's a lot of things out there. But really it was the Lyme, the recognition of Lyme disease that really brought human tick-borne diseases to the forefront. I think most of you are probably familiar with the story, the recognition of Lyme and a cluster of cases of children that were diagnosed with juvenile rheumatoid arthritis there in Lyme and O. Lyme, Connecticut. Even though it had a long history in Europe. And Polly Murray, who is one of the women that basically brought the Lyme to the attention of Alan Steer at Yale, and the whole story unfolded from there, actually wrote a book called The Widening Circle, which was published in 1996. I don't know whether this library has a copy, but it's actually a very fascinating book on the early years there of emergence of Lyme disease. And she noted there, when she moved to that area during the late 1950s and then through the 1960s and 70s, her husband, four children, and her were periodically plagued with all these mysterious symptoms. She was tested for lupus a lot of times. They started to say it was basically, they were trying to, some doctors were accusing it was all in her head and all that, but no, it was a new disease. Okay, but Lyme isn't new. Okay, so the oldest known human case of Lyme disease is over 5,000 years ago. They found evidence that the Iceman in Europe was infected with the Borrelia that causes Lyme. He was so well preserved, all the genetic work that they were able to do with the evidence that he had Lyme disease. So when everybody says it's new, well, not really. We'll get into the history of that here just in a moment. So since its first recognition in the papers that Alan Steer published in the mid-1970s, the number of cases of Lyme disease have continued to increase. So the number of reported cases to the CDC runs around somewhere between around 35,000, if plus or minus, cases every year right now. But only about 10% of the diagnosed cases end up getting reported to the CDC. So the actual estimate of a true incidence of Lyme in the United States is somewhere between 300 and 350,000 cases. There's a lot of Lyme disease out there. Okay, We're also seeing a steady increase, as you can see, of the other some of the other diseases, anaplasmosis, ehrlichiosis, and the spotted fever, rickettsiosis, also are continuing to increase in numbers.
Can you add a couple of slides back? You list a whole bunch of the diseases, but you say there are some of them are reportable to the CDC. What makes it reportable?
They're reportable if the CDC requires that they're reportable. States don't necessarily have nationally reportable. Now, some states, like babesiosis, has been reportable here in this state for a very long time. But it only became nationally reportable in 2011. I guess it has to do with the severity of the disease and the increasing frequency of the disease, things like that, as make their determination whether it's reportable or not. So nationally, if you look at the map, you'll see here through the northeast, you have Lyme, which is in purple, babesiosis in yellow, ehrlichiosis, which is actually in yellow, in blue, anaplasmosis in green. Mainly up in the northeast and the upper Midwest. Rocky Mountain spotted fever, you'll see most of the cases are running in a band from the Carolinas to Oklahoma and Kansas. A lot of ehrlichiosis is down in the southeast. And so here, but even out west, see here you've got tick-borne relapsing fever and Colorado tick fever. So there's not really no place in the United States that you can run and hide and escape ticks and tick-borne diseases. But you can see the northeast here certainly has more than its fair share. So why are we having all this? Where did all this come from? Okay. So the answer in the current climate really has to do with our history here. You look at Connecticut today, and it's surprisingly largely what?
Forested.
Mm-hmm. Or northeast. It's all forested. Interestingly enough, there was a Swedish naturalist named Per Kalm who came here in this night by around the 1750s. Okay, and he published a journal of his travels in 1770, and he noticed numerous, several times in his journals, it's a fascinating book, actually, to these I must add the wood lice, which the forests are so pestered that it's impossible to pass through a bush or sit down, though the place be ever so pleasant without having a whole swarm of them on your clothes. He was in New Jersey at the time, talking about ticks were extremely abundant. Okay. A century after that, the state entomologist of New York, Asa Finch, noticed that the most common tick of our country, the wood tick, though formerly abundant throughout the northern and middle states, has now become nearly or quite extinct. At this day along the route Kalm pursued, not one can be found. What happened in that intervening 100 years? Any ideas? Huh?
Forest.
We cut down almost of the trees.
Yeah.
So if you look at the percent forest cover here, you'll see it's all of the 16, 1700s until about 1830 or so, a steady decline in forest cover. Forests were cut down to make room for farming, for fuel, and so on. Then, about that time, lands opened up out west. People started leaving our tough farming grounds here to go out to Ohio and so on. And also we had the Industrial Revolution started. And so people started moving to the mill towns for employment. And the forest started coming back. We're starting to lose a little bit of ground now, but Connecticut is now about 58-59% forested today. There was another big change. And that was the number of white-tailed deer. Okay, it is estimated in 1896 there were 12 deer in Connecticut. How many have that mean in your backyard right now? Okay, well, we currently estimates the survey. These are surveys done by DEEP, and then extrapolated from what they observe on their helicopter surveys. Well, the current population is somewhere around 124,000, 125,000 deer in the state today. Okay. And so what we see then is a picture of conditions coming back. The tick probably survived on the eastern end of Long Island. We have records from going way back of the tick. Islands off the Cape where deer were not hunted out. were private hunting preserves and so forth, and so the tick survived on Shelter Island, the Elizabethan Islands, and places like that. And then as conditions became suitable, they simply started spreading again. Based on, actually, some of the first Lyme disease tests were developed at the Agricultural Experiment Station, and free testing was offered to physicians through the State Health Department in a study in 1984-85, which gave us our first glimpse of the distribution of Lyme disease at that time, most of which you can see was still down in the southeastern part of the state. Since then, over the 40 years it was recognized, you can see how its number of human cases had spread in 1996 and here by 2015. So there has been a steady expansion of the tick and its range and a steady expansion in the number of people that are at risk of tick bite and Lyme disease.
How did they associate it with the tick that would go on a deer?
Mm-hmm.
How did they associate the origin with the deer?
Well, I'll get to that, because the deer is the main host for the adult stage of the tick.
Okay, we'll get to that. Why it was the deer?
Deer. No deer. And I can get into that. I'm going to show you some examples of that. If you have no deer, the tick just will disappear.
So the tick needs an animal to survive?
For reproduction. I mean, there's multiple hosts involved, but the deer is a key player, as we'll get to in a little bit, okay? So when we talk about tick species we're dealing with, we have our black-legged tick, Exotis scapularis, which you all know commonly as the deer tick. We have the American dog tick, and we have the Lone Star tick, which is a southeastern species, which is also becoming increasingly abundant because of the increase in the deer population, not just here, but through the United States, and it's moving north. Okay, it's been steadily moving north. And then, of course, the tick that transmits Lyme disease out along the Pacific coast is the western black-legged tick. Now, the majority of the ticks that we get submitted to the tick testing laboratory are black-legged ticks. So in 2016, it made up 85% of the ticks that were submitted to the experiment station for identification and testing. A handful of American dog ticks, about 12%, and we had 91 Lone Star ticks that were submitted by residents in 2016. And that's been, its numbers are still low, but it's been steadily going up. And I'll get back to the Lone Star tick here in a moment. So the two ticks you're most likely to encounter here, of course, is our black-legged tick or deer tick and the American dog tick. Now, all stages of the black-legged tick will feed on us and our pets, okay? Only the adult stage of the dog tick will feed on us or our pets. So the larvae and the nymphs of the American dog tick, it's very, very rare to find one attached to a human, okay? They just don't like us, and it's very easy to tell them apart. The confusion often comes in when you have a fully engorged tick, because there's a lot of overlap in size. But there are white markings on the back of a American dog tick. Those white markings are not present on the black-legged tick. And that little plate, which is why we call them hard ticks, is still evident even in an engorged tick. It makes it very easy to tell the two apart. American dog ticks do not transmit Lyme disease. Okay. So let's take a little closer look at the life cycle.
I'm sorry,
yes.
Just clarify again, so it's on the deer tick that transfers the
Lyme. Correct.
Okay. And no babesiosis or anything else?
Well, there's multiple things that are transmitted by our deer tick.
The dog tick?
Dog tick, Rocky Mountain spotted fever and tularemia, but we haven't had a case in Connecticut in years upon years upon years. I'm not saying it could happen, but it's very, very uncommon here. Okay, so these ticks that we're talking about are what we call three-host ticks, which means each stage requires a different host to feed on. There are a few one-host ticks and two-host ticks, but all of these that we're dealing with here are three-host ticks, which means the larval stage, the nymphal stage, and the adult stage have to feed on a separate host animal. So what happens is that, okay, the female will lay the eggs. In the case of our black-legged tick, you're talking about 2,000 eggs. The egg, the larval ticks will hatch from that. They're not infected, okay? They become infected when they feed on an infected mouse or chipmunk, in a few cases birds. Then they, after they feed, they drop off molt to the nymphal stage. The nymph then has to find a host all over again. Once the nymph finds a host and feeds, it drops off, molts, and becomes an adult tick, either male or female. And the adult stage feeds on medium to large animals. So the adult ticks, the female ticks, will feed on dogs, cats, fox, coyotes. But deer is the primary and preferred host for the adult tick. Okay.
Do the ticks ever feed on carcasses?
Hmm?
Do they ever feed on carcasses?
On what?
Carcasses.
No. They're dead. I mean, if there are already ticks on them, they'll just drop off. So hunters that are going out and shooting deer, you know, they'll hang them after the hunt, and we'll have a lot of ticks falling off of that animal. So anyway, so what we have here, okay, so here's a nymphal tick. If you look at this white-footed mouse very carefully right here, you can see larval ticks on the ears of this animal. If you look at this veery, you'll see the ticks right around the eye. On it. Birds are heavily parasitized by our black-legged tick. So looking a little more closely here, this happens to be a bunch of Lone Star ticks on a deer. Massive infestation. Like I said, black-legged ticks will generally lay about 2,000 eggs. Lone Star ticks, you're talking about 1,000 to 8,000 eggs, although the average is about 3. Here you've got a female tick that is, here that I did a study, and here are the larval ticks hatching from that egg mass. The female tick dies after she lays that egg mass. So here I've got a larger picture of this. Again, you can see the larval ticks feeding on this mouse. If this white-footed mouse is a reservoir host, it carries the Lyme pathogen. And if when the ticks feed on that mouse, it becomes infected. And then as a nymph, it can reinfect more mice. So basically Lyme cycles. The ticks infect a new generation of mice, which then infect a new generation of ticks, and that's how it's maintained. So the mouse is what we call a reservoir host. It's the source of infection for the ticks.
If an animal eats the infected mouse, does it transfer blood?
No. It does not. Has to be bitten. Has to be fed upon. Because there's a dynamic process. It's a vector-borne disease, so the ticks have to transmit it. Okay? And again, on the veery. So, this life cycle is 2 years for a black-legged tick. So seasonally, if you look at each stage, larva, nymph, and adult, the eggs are laid in May. Female ticks will lay all those eggs in May. The larvae will hatch from those eggs around mid-July. So August is the peak month of larval tick activity. Once those larvae feed, they drop off, molt to nymphs, and they will pass through the winter as nymphs and become active the following May, June, and July. So the nymphs this past, summer, okay, well then, after they feed, they drop off and they will be the adults this fall. So the adult deer ticks that are about ready to emerge here shortly this fall were nymphal ticks this past summer and were larval ticks last August. So it takes 2 years to run through the whole life cycle.
Does the severity of the winter affect the nymphs over winter?
It can. We've been doing some overwintering studies. We found actually that there was a greater abundance of nymphal ticks on summers that were followed by a wetter winter. Mild, not so much. I think or snow cover. Snow cover is an insulating blanket. So everybody says, "Oh man, it was a really horrible winter. We had a lot of snow." They're doing just fine because snow's an insulator. Okay. All right. So you have this life cycle here seasonally, and the adults come out in the fall. And they do not hibernate. They'll be active in the winter if it's warm enough. And then you get a secondary peak in the spring. Okay?
So any of the stages can be infected?
Larvae are not infected.
Larvae are not infected.
Not
Not initially until they...
They have to, they feed on a mouse or a chipmunk, a few species of birds, shrews, to become, to acquire the Lyme bacteria. And then when they become a nymph, they're infected. They can become, if they didn't get infected the first time, then as a nymph they can get infected. So infection rates in adults tend to be a little bit higher because they've had two opportunities to become infected. Deer are not, are what we call reservoir incompetent. They're key to the reproductive success of the tick, but they have nothing to do with the Lyme part of the cycle. They do not infect ticks. Okay? So if you look at the Lyme disease cases by month of onset from the Department of Public Health and overlay it with the seasonal, you'll see that the peak here is right corresponding with the nymphs. Majority of Lyme disease cases occur in the summer from the very small nymphal stage. And you do get much less from the adults. It's because they're easier to spot. It's just basically that simple. Okay. And of course, summer, people are outdoors more, you're wearing shorts, so on. And so, what can we do about it? So when we look at all the various things that we've been examining in terms of managing your exposure to ticks and tick-borne diseases, we look at all the possibilities in an integrated tick management program. Education and behavior change is important. Personal protection measures are extremely important. There are landscape modifications that can be done to at least reduce the suitability of the habitat for ticks. Of course, there's chemical control, spraying for ticks, either synthetic insecticides or the so-called botanicals or so-called natural compounds. Some work on biological control we've done. We've also looked at host reduction or exclusion, host-targeted acaricides, and host-targeted vaccines. And I'm going to kind of highlight quickly many of these. Of course, education is important. Anybody go out, how many of you seen signs warning you about ticks before you, you know, go hiking somewhere on one particular track of property or forest or a preserve or something like that? I've seen a number of these signs in a number of different places. Education is important. Just being aware of the ticks and how to handle it is extremely important. And just being here is part of that. And the brochure that we just passed out will help. But in terms of your risk, where are you most likely to pick up Lyme disease? Now, a survey that was done by the Stanford Health Department for ticks that were being submitted to the experiment station for testing found that 74% there said that they picked up their ticks outdoors at home, 21% away from the home. So Lyme, for most people, is a paradomestic disease. You pick it up right around your own home. You can pick it up hiking or camping or something like that, but most people get them right around their own home. If you look at the activities that people were doing, the highest risk for the ticks that were coming in was play, followed by things like yard work, 18% of the tick submissions, gardening, 12%. Those are high-risk activities.
One means of prevention I noticed you didn't have up there was chickens and turkeys, which I have recently learned eat ticks.
Yes and no.
Okay. Do they just eat in certain stages, or?
There's very little evidence that they actually eat them.
Okay.
And they're birds, and ticks feed on birds.
What?
They're birds, so ticks feed on birds.
Uh-huh.
They're also hosts. So there hasn't been a whole lot of work done in terms of guinea fowl and things like that. There was one experiment where unfed ticks were given to turkeys, and turkeys didn't eat them. Now, one possibility, one of the turkeys have actually been tied to the explosion of Lone Star tick populations. They're a major host for Lone Star ticks. So there's not a lot, I'm just saying, there's not a lot of evidence that the birds actually have an impact. Now, it's possible they could be feeding on those fully engorged ticks down in the leaf litter, you know, but not the unfed or flat ticks, okay? So it's mainly, those are your high risks. Mainly 3/4 of the cases probably acquired from a tick bite right around the home. So your personal protection measures, of course, clothing. I know people probably don't do this. I mean, when I'm out doing tick work, do I tuck my pants and my socks? Yes. Okay. You can use a skin-based repellent, like, you know, DEET or Picaridin. You can use a permethrin-based tick repellent. That's a clothing only. It's the insecticide permethrin, which you can apply to your clothes. And then, of course, doing bathing and tick checks when you come back in. So, like I said, you have a diversity of repellents. The thing about deep, if you're for mosquitoes, lower concentrations are fine, but for ticks, you really need to get up that 25-30% to be that effective. Picaridin is another possible choice. Oil of lemon and eucalyptus is a possible choice. But again, you want to get that 20-30% concentration here for that. Now, the clothing repellent that you can buy is sold under several brands. It's 0.5% permethrin, which is an insecticide. It's the same insecticide that's used in malarial bed nets. So ticks that come in contact with the treated clothes are repelled and killed. It's what I use. It's highly effective if you're doing something in really high risk of tick bite. You can buy the spray and spray your socks, pants, so forth, you know, following label directions, applying it before, let it dry, and then get dressed. But there's also companies that sell pre-treated permethrin clothing. So you have two options there for protection with the permethrin.
Without any studies about the effects on humans?
It's pretty non-toxic to humans. We metabolize it. It has very low skin absorption, but you don't want to apply it directly to the skin. I mean, it is an insecticide, so you're minimizing your exposure to it that way. To me, I'm balancing the low risk of the permethrin versus the high risk of a tick bite and getting Lyme disease. So, but let's say you didn't take any protection measures or they weren't enough, and you come back, you do a tick check. The shower's a good time to check yourself over. And I will emphasize that the deer tick can be found on the body anywhere. And I'll leave it at that. Okay? I've gotten reports from all that. There's not a single part of the anatomy that hasn't had a tick attached. Okay? All right. So, tick removal. You've all heard wives' tales and so forth about the match and petroleum jelly. The idea is to remove the tick as soon as possible. Okay? And so the best way to do it is I use fine tip forceps. That's what I like. So what we have here, oops. There we go. Okay, so this right here is an engorged nymph with a common straight pin for size comparison. And that's an engorged one. Okay? So here's a nymph and here's a female. Male deer ticks, by the way, do not require a blood meal. It's very rare to find the males attached. Other tick species, yes, but Ixodes ticks, no. So the idea is you come in as close to the skin as possible, just grasp it right around the mouth parts, and gently and firmly pull it out. Put it in a little snack Ziploc bag or something similar, some small container, so you can have it identified if you want to have it tested. Don't tape it to anything or something like that, and record when and where you were bitten, so at least you have a reference if you need to talk to your physician. So let's talk about the biting process itself. Now, the mouth parts of a tick aren't like a mosquito, which are like hypodermic. They come in, they feed in the capillary, 2 minutes later, they're done, and they're gone. Ticks feed for days. They have to set their mouth parts, become engorged, and then drop off. Okay, so a nymphal deer tick requires 4 days for full engorgement. A female deer tick requires 5 to 7 days for full engorgement. So if you find a fully engorged female tick in the sheets of your bed, it's been on you for a week and you didn't know it. Unless it came off your dog, if you're having your dog sleep with you. So anyway, so let's just talk about the mouth parts here. As you can see, this is the head. This is an adult deer tick. This is a nymph. The mouth parts are three-pronged structures. These are palps, which are like sensory in function. This is the head of the tick. So these are called the chelicerae. So on the top, those are the blades the tick uses to actually cut into the skin. And then this part right here called the hypostome is like a lower lip with all those little recurved denticles. So the tick cuts into the skin, and then once it's inserted those mouth parts, it immediately starts secreting a cement-like material. Some ticks a lot more than others, but basically that helps hold fast, helps the tick secure itself to the skin. Then it continues to salivate a lot of pharmacologically active compounds, proteases to dissolve tissue, vasodilators, anticoagulants, anti-immune suppressive compounds. But it's not in the tick's interest to have you itch or notice that it's there right away. So basically what it does is it creates the small lesion under the skin that the blood is, you know, disrupted, it's, you know, feeding into, and then the tick is basically going through this process of spitting and sucking, okay, throughout those days, and slowly taking a big meal. Most of the blood meals take in the last 24 hours of feeding, so it's slowly getting bigger. And then the last 24 hours, it'll complete engorgement. And one scientist called that the grand slurp. So, and then once it's done, it'll pull its mouth parts in and just, you know, drop off. Okay? Now, interestingly enough, the spirochetes, the bacteria, type bacteria that cause Lyme disease, are in the midgut of the tick. So when the blood starts to be taken in, they multiply. And they actually have to penetrate the gut wall and migrate through the body of the tick to the salivary glands before they can be injected in the feeding process. That's why you have a delay in transmission. Okay? In addition to that, the spirochetes change their outer surface proteins. They change their appearance to the immune system. So they're expressing OspA, outer surface protein A, which is an adhesion molecule in the gut, in the tick. But as it moves to the salivary glands, there's some other changes. But the main one is it quits making OspA and starts making OspC, which seems to be essential for mammal infection. Okay, so there's also another change that takes place. So you've got that time that it takes to make that shift. So when you look at your risk, okay, all right, so this is the probability of an infected nymph transmitting Borrelia burgdorferi, the Lyme spirochetes, in duration of attachment. So at 24 hours, it's zero. They haven't gotten to the salivary glands yet. But as they start to arrive in the salivary glands, the probability starts going up. 48 hours, the tick's been attached, it's 12% from an infected tick. 72 hours, 75, and then by 96 hours when the tick's finished feeding, it's almost virtually 100%. So the longer the tick is on, the greater the chance of transmission. And that applies to anaplasmosis and babesiosis too. It's a totally different mechanism, but there's I'm not going to get into that on time, but there's a maturation process and so forth. So they're not transmitted immediately either. It takes about 24 hours for the agents that cause babesia and osis and anaplasmosis to be transmitted. Powassan virus can be transmitted within 15 to 30 minutes. Okay? A little faster. That's a little different. But your risk isn't just how long it's attached, it's whether it's infected at all. So if you look at the tick testing results here, for the tick submitted to the experiment station, you can see that in 2015, 2016, you're looking at around, you know, 53 to 65% were uninfected. So you've got roughly 50-50 odds here that the tick isn't even infected to begin with, okay? Only about 30% of the ticks were infected with the Lyme spirochetes, Borrelia burgdorferi. Between 7 and 11% were infected with Babesia microti that causes babesiosis. 5% with anaplasma, phagocytophilum, which causes anaplasmosis. And then you have lower rates of co-infection. So you can get Lyme and babesiosis from one tick bite, or more than one tick bite, but one co-infected tick can give you both, okay? And then if you're winner of the grand tick lottery, you got bitten by this one that's infected by all three pathogens and you end up sick with all three diseases at the same time. Doesn't happen very often, but it can happen. So that's your risk and personal protection measure. So let's move on to landscape or vegetative management. Most ticks require high humidity. Yes?
So if we go back to the previous slide, is that cumulative? Right? So you can get Lyme disease at 30% plus?
No. So these are ticks that were just had Borrelia burgdorferi. So 31% had just the Lyme spirochete.
Borrelia down there, so it's actually more than 31%, it's 36%.
But with this broken out, these are 31 had just Borrelia.
Yeah, but for me...
Yeah, the rate's a little higher if you throw in these co-infections.
For me getting bitten, I have the 31% plus the 4% plus the 1.9%.
Well, that's true. For the co-infections. But this is specific, I broke it out for those that were singly infection versus those that were co-infection. You're correct. So, like I said, ticks require high humidity and cover generally for survival. They don't take dry conditions very well. And as we think about this habitat, I'll just point out, do you realize that New England has 240,000 miles of stone walls? Which are essentially mouse hotels. And like I said, forest land covers about 1.85 million acres of Connecticut's total land area. So we have a lot of habitat out there. And what I found is that in the typical residential lawns, I spent a few years sampling, I won't say quite every square inch, but the entire properties. And what I found is that 80, on the lawn, 82% of the ticks on residential lawns within 1 meter of the edge with the woods or stone walls. Mm. Okay? 18% were greater than 3 meters, so there are some scattered ticks further out in the lawn, but most of them are right within that edge zone area. And then, of course, if you look at this, again, 82% were adjacent to woods and stone walls. Stone walls by themselves are woods where you have that habitat. But I've also collected adult ticks in Pakisandra right next to doorsteps right by the garden hose. So you don't necessarily have to go in the woods to pick up a tick. And the way we sample ticks generally is what we call dragging for ticks. You know, we have plots or transects. We drag it along, ticks will grab a hold of the material just like they would an animal's hair or your clothing, so on. Interestingly enough, the Popular Science in November 2004 called tick collecting one of the worst jobs in science. But in any event, that's how we actually do most of our sampling. We can also we also monitor tick abundance by live trapping the white-footed mice and counting the ticks that are on them as well. Yes?
Do they actually climb plants and attach them inside, or is it strictly on the ground?
So it depends. So the larval and nymphal stages of the tick will be down in the leaf litter, the very low vegetation. They don't get high. Their main hosts are down there, the mouse, the birds, ground foraging birds, chipmunks. They desiccate easy. Deer, of course, are somewhat larger animals, so the adult stage of the tick will be at ground level, but they'll also get in the shrub layer. But they're not up in the trees, they're not dropping down from above, they don't fly, they don't jump, you know, they just wait with their arms outstretched, and they pick up they can feel the vibrations from your footsteps, the CO2 in your breath, and so forth, and they just latch really quickly. And they can crawl amazingly fast. So most of them are picked up on the lower extremities, and even the ones in your head, unless like you've been on your knees working in the garden or something, probably just crawled all the way up.
How fast is fast?
Hmm?
How fast is fast? In other words, if you get out and you're searching for checking yourself.
You'd be surprised. They can move pretty quickly. I mean, I don't know how to put a speed number on it, but they crawl fairly quickly.
So they don't drop out of trees?
They don't drop out of trees. If it's in your head, you picked it up, just didn't notice it, and it just crawled up.
What about rush, ramble?
Well, again, the adults will get into that shrub layer because they feed mainly on white-tailed deer, so they will get a little higher in the vegetation. Adult ticks, yeah, they'll get a little higher in vegetation, yes.
But they still need contact with the victim.
They have to make direct contact. They don't have jumping legs. They don't have wings. We'd be a whole different world if ticks had wings. Okay.
With the application of D to detach or reattach ticks or not?
Is what?
If you apply DEET.
DEET?
After, will attached ticks fall off or no?
No, that's a repellent to prevent them from attaching. Okay, so. So basically, from an environmental standpoint, you think about, you know, the woods around your property is the tick zone. They, you know, you're less likely to find them in the open areas, so you want to move swing sets out away from the woods, put in wood chip barriers, maybe do a perimeter pesticide spray. There's a number of tactics that you can use to try to reduce your risk right along the edge of the yard. Now, how many of you have barberry right behind your house? Anybody here Japanese barberry? Stands? Okay. Great habitat. Okay. It's invasive, as you know, in our woodlands, and it provides great habitat for the ticks and the mice and so on. So tick populations are actually quite high in barberry areas of the woods relative to, say, open areas of the woods. So in a study that was done in controlling Japanese barberry, mainly for more from a forest regeneration standpoint and an invasive plant standpoint, in the process of doing that, they found that ticks were very abundant in areas with dense Japanese barberry. There was a lot more larval ticks on the mice that were in the barberry. And when they reduced the amount of Japanese barberry from 62% of cover down to 3% by mechanical cutting and burning, they reduced the number of infected ticks in those areas by 60%. So I'm just saying, if you had dense stands of barberry immediately behind your house, you might want to think about having it removed.
I read the study, and it's because barberry keeps moist.
That's part of it. So you've got a combination of nice habitat that it provides. Mice have a little more protection from predators. It certainly doesn't stop the deer from going through it. You know, so you've got this really nice, ideal kind of habitat for the tick.
You may have covered this when we're talking about the different stages, but the different stages, the larvae and the adult, they need to be in different posts. And is the adult, besides the deer, what else?
Any medium to larger animals. So you're talking dogs, cats, fox, coyotes,
so if you have
so on.
The mice around and birds, and they might get the lower stages infected. If you have no deer and no dogs and no larger animals, what happens?
You'll see. I'm going to get into that.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
What about squirrels?
Oh, yeah, squirrels are hosts. This tick's, one of the big factors is this tick is not selective. It'll feed on anything. The only restriction being that the adult female requires a somewhat larger host. The mouse or chipmunk is birds, it's not suitable. But it doesn't really care where blood meal comes from. Squirrels, little less, they're a little better. Some animals like squirrels are a little better at grooming themselves, for example. So even though they'll tend to carry fewer ticks just simply because of better grooming behavior, but they pick them up. Okay? Spraying is an option. You can spray for ticks any of the standard ornamental turf insecticides, which are mainly pyrethroids, but also include carbamate like 7, are extremely effective in controlling ticks. We've been doing a lot of work looking at alternatives, natural occurring plant extract compounds. I will tell you up front, most of them do not work. I spent several years working with this fungus. It's a naturally occurring insect fungus in the soil. Called Metarhizium anisophili. It is now available as a product called MET52, and it's the spores of this fungus, and then if ticks encounter it, they then can become infected and it will kill the tick. This isn't a female that's been killed by the fungus. So it's a biological alternative to a chemical, synthetic chemical insecticide that could be used. A lot more expensive, but it is an alternative to your chemicals for spraying. MET52. Yeah, if you do a search, just put MET52, you'll find you'll get references to it. I couldn't even get it in 2016. What stock they had, they sold out. They were redoing their formulation plant. They built this produced in these big fermentation vats, and say they were up in Canada, and they were remodeling it or doing something with it, so the stocks were kind of limited that year. And I got about 70-75% control with it, so it's not going to be quite as good as a synthetic chemical, but like I said, it's a natural alternative. It doesn't affect people or doesn't affect bees. You know, it only affects certain insects. Host targeted control is another approach that's gotten a lot of work. So it's focused mainly on white-tailed deer or the rodent reservoirs like the mice and the chipmunks. And so the approaches have been exclusion. I found that actually excluding deer, I did a study in Lyme and O'Lyme with a couple of properties that were surrounded by high-tense electric deer fences. One was about 15 acres and the other was about eight acres. And the number of ticks inside, it didn't impact. You're not stopping small animal movements, so the number of ticks immediately inside the fence wasn't any different than outside, but it just dropped off. So further inside the properties, you just didn't see hardly any ticks. It reduced the number. There were no larval ticks, 84% reduction in nymphal ticks and 74% in the adult ticks. Quite dramatic. So even on the scale of acres, just excluding the deer had a big impact on tick density. Reduction of deer has been looked at. We'll talk about that a little bit more, just reducing the deer population. And then treatment of deer, and I'll talk about this as well. With this device called a fork poster. Then for the rodents, you have, well, the first product was this cotton ball tubes. I tested it back in the early 1990s when it came out. Didn't have that much of an impact. Mice don't necessarily collect the cotton for nesting material. I mean, they may or may not. If they don't need it, they won't touch it. You know, if there's a lot of alternative material in the environment, they won't even touch it. The idea is they take it back as the nesting material and the permethrin-treated cotton then kills the ticks. Then another product that's come along is a fipronil bait box. It contains a non-toxic food block inside, so the chipmunks and mice will come in. There's a wick here that contains fipronil. You know what fipronil is? It's the active ingredient in Frontline. So one drop on a mouse, that mouse then will kill any ticks that feed on it for up to 30 days. So the idea is if you can treat enough of the mice, then they'll be running around the environment killing ticks instead of infecting ticks. Now, it was originally tested on Mason's Island in Mystic, Connecticut, and what we got there is because every resident's got the bait boxes, we wiped the ticks out on the island. The trick is every resident's was being treated. We're still trying to get our hands around the impact for individual homes. If you buy it and none of your neighbors do, it's really going to restrict the impact somewhat. Okay, deer reduction. So I'll give you an example of this. This was a study that was done in Mumford Cove community, which is a private community in Groton, Connecticut. It's a self-taxing residence area. And the residents made the decision to lower the deer numbers there in the property through a series of controlled hunts. So here, what you'll see, we reduced the deer from about 122 per square mile, huge density, to about 13 deer per square mile. And here you can see, here's deer density. The hunt was commenced, the numbers dropped off. You can see 2 years, given the 2-year life cycle, you can see the nymphal numbers started dropping off. And then here on this chart, you'll see the deer density dropping, and you'll see the number of cases of Lyme disease in the community also crashing. So it had quite an impact. So we had an 76% reduction in tick abundance, 80% reduction in resident reported cases of Lyme disease. So basically, this supports some other research that around 10 to 13 or so deer per square mile, if you can get the population that low, it'll actually significantly impact your tick abundance and risk of Lyme disease. Now,
what happened in 2008 that it spiked, or 2006 that the nymphal thing spiked again?
Well, you're going to get some fluctuations there, but if you compare it with the greater, what's not on here, the greater Groton community, actually, the number of Lyme disease cases decreased there too because there was a shift in the reporting. But then, right after that, the numbers there in the and the surrounding Groton community just went way, way back up. So there was a brief lag there that was a reporting issue rather than a, you know, true incidence of Lyme issue, which complicated things a little bit. But like I said, if you compare the surrounding community with that, there's a huge difference. Okay, I will mention that the Monhegan Island off of Maine, okay, deer were brought there for specific purposes of hunting. And super high deer densities, about 13% of the island residents got Lyme disease every year. They got tired of that. They brought in a professional sharpshooter. They eliminate all the deer on the island. And guess what? There's no more ticks. They get a few ticks that come in off migrating birds. Okay, every, you know, so you'll get a few. But that's it. No deer, no ticks. So, we've looked at all these methods, and not other than the exception like Monhegan Island or something, there hasn't been any one approach that really, you know, ticks are everywhere. That's really been a tough issue to handle. So we've been looking at an integrated tick management approach, using the host-targeted methods, the spraying, things like this, to try to reduce tick abundance enough to impact the risk of disease. We just finished up a study in Redding, Connecticut, using a biopesticide, the rodent bait boxes that I mentioned. We also tried doing some deer reduction. We didn't have a whole lot of success with that because the hunters actually interfered with our efforts, and we were targeting just two neighborhoods in the entire town of Redding. We've been doing some studies with a reservoir-targeted vaccine. So this is the idea, is that you would vaccinate the mice, which are reservoirs, and hopefully if they're unable to infect ticks, you would lower the tick infection rate and thereby the risk of disease. These are all approaches that we're trying. And we're getting ready to start a new study, right, next door in Guilford, again, looking at the four posters again, but combining them with the rodent bait boxes and the Met 52 spraying. So the four poster itself was a device that was developed by the USDA down in Texas to address Lone Star ticks and cattle fever ticks on deer. And what it is, it's a bin that holds the corn. It has four paint rollers on it. The paint rollers are treated with a topical insecticide. So it's sort of like putting the equivalent of doing Frontline on your dog for the deer. So here's some pastures down there in Texas. You can see all the Lone Star ticks all over the ears of this animal. And this was a treated pasture, no ticks. Okay? So they patented this device, and we did a major study with this here in the Northeast from 1997 to 2004. It was a multi-state, so I ran it, the one in Old Lyme, Connecticut. They also had the four posters in New Jersey, in Bedford, New York, down over in Narragansett, Rhode Island, and a couple of sites down in Maryland. And these are the results of using the four posters. So this is the percent control for the entire study for all of the states from the meta-analysis. We had 71% control by the sixth year, and we reduced the risk of tick bite by 68%, as much as 84% at most sites. So you can see the degree of control steadily increased as the deer were treated year after year after year. Okay, and then there was no treatment in year six, so we still had the carryover, but you can see that the efficacy then, treatment effects started to decline 2 years after we quit treating the deer in these mile square mile areas in each of the states. But it did have an impact. But interestingly, I had a Master of Public Health student go back and look at our study here in Connecticut, and what she found, she looked at the human Lyme disease case data, and what we found was is that we had a small but significant reduction in disease in the area where we had the four posters versus the comparison communities around it. So we actually managed to have an impact on disease. One of the biggest problems is we know we can kill ticks, but actually reducing the incidence of disease has been a real difficult thing to show. So right now, as far as the four posters go, there's that, I just summarized the original Northeast Area Project, but there's been a number of other studies. There was one that was just finished out on Cape Cod and the islands. There was a study that was down on Shelter Island and Fire Island, New York. The four posters are actually currently running on Mason's Island, where we did the original bait box study. And like I said, we're getting ready to start a new integrated project over in some neighborhoods in Guilford as well. So, and then I, to summarize all the work that that's been done with the four posters, I just published a review article on that as well. So when you look at what works, this is actually a study that was done a long time ago using a computer model. And what it found was is that under a hypothetical community of 10,000 individuals, it basically looked at several scenarios, like a basic scenario. Worst case would be one where people aren't using it very well, and the best case where you've got optimum use of that particular intervention. And then they found that under best scenarios, insecticides or treating the deer gave the best outcome in the model. Lyme disease vaccine did the best, assuming everybody had it and took it, okay? Worst scenario, again, we're still talking an impact on deer had a big impact. Vaccine came in 3. So those are the methods, at least in the model, seem to have the greatest impact on disease. So when we look at all of these methods, I mean, what does it take to use these things? First of all, any of these interventions has to be acceptable, and you have to use it, right? It can't be too expensive. One of the drawbacks to the bait box, preventing its wider use by people, is it's not cheap. Ease of maintenance, okay? Four posters do get a little maintenance heavy. It has to be safe. Ideally, it would be self-propagating. I don't see anything, or self-sustaining, I don't see that. It has to be a technique that can be used in varied environments, and of course it has to be effective. And some of you may have seen the article that just came out in the Hartford Current. The University of Massachusetts Medical School is claiming they've got a new vaccine that they're going to test. It actually isn't a vaccine as such. It uses a human antibody to protect against Lyme disease, they claim, for up to 6 months, but they've got to face some, you know, obviously do some human testing trials, you know, before that could happen. That would be a valuable tool, but that wouldn't address the other tick-borne diseases. So when you look at what people actually use, this was a survey that was done, and here in New England you'll see that almost 30% reported tick exposure in a household member in the year that they were asking about in the survey. And then they were asked what kind of prevention measures that they used. So here in New England, a quarter claimed they were using a repellent. 43% claimed they were doing tick checks, but 36% were saying they did nothing. Okay, only 7% were spraying for ticks, and 14% they would absolutely not use any yard pesticides at all. So when you look at our toolbox that we have, you got your various different personal protection measures. Vaccination, human vaccine would be ideal, but we don't have one at the current time. The landscape stuff I mentioned, various different methods of killing the host-seeking ticks in the environment. You know, I mentioned the fungal acaricide with the MET-52. There's a work being done to use an attractant combined with the pesticide, so you would actually still have an insecticide, but you would have lower concentrations because you've got an attractant mixed in with it. That's something that's being looked at now. Oral vaccines, experimental, we're working with that. We have the topical acaricide bait box. Another approach, of course, I mentioned deer fencing, deer reduction. Ideally, what I think would be perfect would be an anti-tick vaccine for the deer. So if you could vaccinate the deer, so that means when the ticks feed on the deer, they die. That would be, I think, a really nice, you still got delivery issues, but. So where do we go from here? I kind of quickly reviewed a lot of the tools we have available for killing ticks, but if you spray for ticks, it doesn't necessarily mean you've necessarily reduced your risk of actually getting Lyme disease or one of the other tick-borne diseases. But I think an IPM or an integrated pest management approach is your best option until we actually have a human vaccine in there. So I'll just, one of the things I want to wrap up with here at this point is that I've been focusing on all the ticks. You saw there's so many tick-borne diseases. Ticks are really important, but mosquitoes often get a lot of the attention. And remember how every year across those graphs we always had a new tick-borne disease popping up that we were discovering, and we're still discovering new ones? Well, nothing. Yellow fever, dengue, and then wham! Here we've got West Nile, chikungunya, now Zika. So this whole awareness of these vector-borne diseases, whether tick-borne or mosquito-borne, has led the CDC to realize that not enough resources have been put into either research or training a future generation of entomologists. I mean, when the day comes when I retire, who's going to replace me? Okay, that kind of thing. I mean, we just don't have a cohort of vector-trained entomologists or vector biologists, a lot of them anyway, coming along. So what they did, the CDC funded 5 regional centers of excellence in vector-borne diseases. There's one here in the Northeast, the Southeast, Texas, the Western Gulf Center down in Texas, the upper Midwest, Michigan area, and then the most recent one, the Pacific Southwest in California. So Cornell is the center lead institution. Half of the money for this grant, 5-year grant, is for education and training a new cohort. So Cornell's instituting a master's program to train future vector biologists or entomologists. We're a major partner in this. It also involves New York State Health Department, Columbia University, and so on. And we also have a lot of partners. So it's a very much a regional project to try to increase our capacity to handle mosquito and tick-borne diseases. So I'll wrap this up with this quote here. From red bugs and bed bugs, from sand flies and land flies, mosquitoes, gala nippers, and fleas, from hog ticks and dog ticks, from hen lice and men lice, we pray thee, good Lord, give us ease. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so now's the time for questions. Catch what?
You could get a Lyme disease and it's taken care of, but you could still get it again.
So in the course of natural infection, you produce antibodies. That's what the testing is done. Okay. It's very low yield. So all your symptoms of Lyme disease are caused by actually a very small amount of the bacteria in you. And so that's why the test is an antibody test. It's very difficult to find the actual spirochetes in an infection. So, but those antibodies are not that protective. So yes, you can get it, be treated and so forth, and then you can get it again. But those antibodies will stay around. I mean, so they are, you can, once you've had Lyme, you can have an antibody test that'll be positive for quite a long time afterwards. So you have to make that differentiation. Is it a new infection or is it just antibodies carrying over from your previous infection?
I have 2 questions about the methods for the treatment. This 4 poster thing, the deer rub against it?
So in other words, you've got those rollers. So there's little corn bin. It holds up to 200 pounds of corn. It dribbles it out in a little tray on either end. So as the deer come in to feed on that, they're rubbing up against the pesticide-treated roller.
So we're talking about posters
only for these. No, the posters are only about this high.
Okay, a couple feet.
Yeah, they're very short. Just so that, because when the deer puts its head and neck down there, they can rub up against it and then get treated. And then the pesticide, it's permethrin. The permethrin is the insecticide, the same stuff that's used on your clothes for treating the deer. The bait box is fipronil, the same ingredient in Frontline.
Okay, how do you say it?
Fipronil.
F or pH?
F. Fipronil. It's the same, it's the active ingredient in Frontline for flea and tick control for dogs and cats.
But it's for mice.
But it's, I mean, but it's put in here on the wick for the mice. It's only 0.7%. It's a low concentration. Your top spot front line is that you put on your dogs and you get the thing open. It's 10%.
But then they bring it back to their little communities of mice.
No, the mice are treated right there in the box. So it's just, it's like treating your dog with front line. But you've treated the mouse with front line.
So then the next generation you have to also treat that.
Well, you have to, you've got to keep,
Keep going.
So the mouse rubs against it.
There's a wick in there, it rubs against it. So it's, yes?
I was going to ask you about locally tick-borne disease effects on dogs and cats, and you could say a few words, I guess.
Okay, so dogs and cats. Due to lack of time, I basically, these are all my actual disease slides. I wouldn't be here for another hour. I thought I put the canine ones in here, but I didn't. There's a lot of products available to help protect dogs and cats. I have a new fact sheet on our website, so I would suggest you go to that, which outlines your protection measures against preventing tick-borne infections, including Lyme disease in dogs and cats. Huh? Okay, so Lyme for dogs. Any dog that's outdoors is going to get bitten by ticks and get infected. Period. Okay? Only about 5% of the dogs will actually get clinically ill. So most dogs that get infected with Lyme actually never manifest any clinical symptoms. But those dogs that get sick can get quite sick. And there's actually a fairly uncommon, but I won't say too uncommon, one thing that can happen in dogs is nephritis. That's kidney failure. And if that happens to your dog, there's nothing your veterinarian can do to save your dog. There is a Lyme vaccine. There's actually several Lyme vaccines for your dog.
Cats?
No. It's only a canine. Cats rarely show symptoms. Very rarely.
Do cats get Lyme symptoms?
Well, but no. Well, you got a different shape. They get infected.
Ah.
But they don't manifest disease.
Okay.
Okay.
A carrier?
Well, not a carrier. Well, a carrier means they would infect other.
Okay. Right.
You know, kind of. They're a dead end host, and they rarely show clinical symptoms.
Right.
Cats very rarely show clinical symptoms.
But if it carries the tick, and then the tick can.
Yeah, but you want to prevent tick bites and other pathogens that the ticks can carry as well. Collars. There's some collars that are extremely effective. There's some new products that last supposed to last a month. It's just a little pill that you give your dog once a month. So I have all of these outlined in my fact sheet that I have on prevention. Bear in mind that any of the insecticides, most insecticide products for are limited to dogs. The pyrethroid insecticides, which are in a number of canine products to kill ticks on dogs, are toxic to cats. So there's very few products that you can use safely on a cat.
So all these host...
Oh, go ahead.
All these host animals don't get sick?
No. They've evolved with it.
They're
carriers.
They just carry.
They carry it, yeah.
The dogs get sick from it.
Right, but he's talking about the wildlife that naturally carry it.
Never show any signs of...
Deer, actually, ironically, the reason they're non-reservoir hosts is their immune system actually turns out to be actually quite good in squashing the Lyme infection. They develop antibodies. You can test deer to see whether or not Lyme is in an area. In fact, that's one of the things we did when Lyme was first emerging. Two ways. We would actually go out and to deer check stations and collect blood samples from the deer that just came in and test them and see whether they were positive yet or not. So basically in those early years, you would have Lyme positive deer down there in the south central part of Connecticut, but up in the northwest hill, they were all still negative because the tick hadn't gotten there yet. I'm talking about the very early emergence years. Okay, canine sero surveys have also been a common tool because the dogs are outdoors all the time, is to do serologic surveys on dogs, and you'll start picking up positive dogs long before you'll see a human case in new areas where disease is just moving into or expanding to.
Is there something about a tick that makes it, I don't know.
The tick, I mean, Pliny the Elder called the tick the foulest and nastiest creature that be. Ticks are a real particular problem. That's what I'm saying. That introductory slide I gave, that they've been such a difficult issue, that they're ubiquitous in the environment. Many of them feed on a wide variety of hosts. They don't fly. You can't bring them into a trap like you would, mosquitoes, for example. They're in that environment that's hard to reach even if you're spraying, because they're down in that ground vegetation that you have to penetrate to. It's been a tough issue. That's why we don't.
It's just because they're blood feeders.
They're blood feeders. They're ubiquitous in the environment. They feed on a lot of different animals. There's very few weak links. Deer, in the case of that tick, is one weak link. But I don't see us going back to like the early colonists did and not taking the deer population in Connecticut back down to 12. The issue with that, it's a lot more complex. And bear in mind, too, that some other techniques, mosquitoes, you've got to remember, only the female feeds on blood, and only the adult. So it's easier to, in some ways, sometimes it's easier to raise mosquitoes in a lab than it is ticks, because you've got to feed each stage of the tick on an animal host to get the next stage, and then until you get to the female tick so she can lay her eggs. Yeah, it's not easy to raise the tick. It's done, but not in the kind of numbers it would take to. Yeah.
Yeah. There's so much confusion about treatment. If you were to get bit by a tick, what treatment would you recommend that you would take for yourself?
Well, the standard treatment for most of these is the proper antibiotic provided by your physician.
But for how long?
Well, you get into controversy. Most people, that standard two-week course is probably fine. The trick is catching it early. It's very important to track it. If you get a tick bite, and then another study actually showed that, and again, remember, you've got a 50-50 chance of having an infected tick, but if taking a single dose of doxycycline within 72 hours, the tick bite will also prevent infection. You're catching it really early. That's an alternative in that window than a full 14 or longer course of taking it. Babesiosis is a protozoan organism, and it's a different set of drugs that you need to treat for that. So babesiosis attacks your red blood cells. It's like having malaria. Okay? And in fact, you may see a headline that just came out August 22nd. A Connecticut man died from babesiosis. Problem was is that he didn't have a spleen, which makes you highly vulnerable to this particular infection. A spleen. Okay? So you can see this tick-borne disease, so this man, he died of kidney failure in a severe case of babesiosis. He was 55 years old. There's also been blood transfusion cases. So babesiosis, actually most people that get babesiosis, the disease is quite limited. So it's people that are older, immune suppressed, or if you don't have a spleen, that most vulnerable to babesiosis. Okay? So the problem with babesia is we don't really know how many people are actually infected, because you can have no symptoms at all or range to severe illness and death. Okay? Runs that whole gambit. All right? So babesiosis is kind of tricky. And you can have co-infection, like I mentioned earlier, with the ticks. Babesiosis actually can increase the severity of Lyme disease. And there have been, like I said, transfusion cases, and it's treated with a different set of drugs. Mm-hmm. And really severe cases, they've actually done exchange blood transfusions before they initiated therapy.
My friend, 68-year-old, golf 3 days a week. Last week was diagnosed with babesiosis. He got a tick bite, didn't do anything about it, had severe headache, chills. I thought he had the flu, it was pneumonia or something. He's been in intensive care for 2 weeks. They gave him full blood transfusion, as they said he was going to die, but he was fine.
Right. So the early diagnosis is really important for this stuff. Yeah, because it's treatable.
He waited.
Yeah, it's treatable. But it's a severe. Anaplasmosis is an infection of your white blood cells. It responds extremely quickly to antibiotic therapy, doxycycline, because it's you take it 48 hours. 48 hours. the key is being recognized that you have a case of anaplasmosis and getting treated properly.
You can get a bite and not see it, though, right?
Yeah, I mean, the majority of people never notice the tick that actually gives them Lyme disease or whatever. Right. The nymphs are extremely small. You saw, I mean, they're just very minute.
The old bullseye thing is nice, but most of the time it doesn't show up, right?
Well, about 70% of the cases. Ehrlichiosis is transmitted by Lone Star ticks. Again, ehrlichiosis and anaplasmosis. It's fever, shaking chills, headache, muscle and joint pain. Symptoms can be mild or severe. There's no real clinical sign other than your white blood cell count really goes down, and again, your risk of becoming really ill is higher the older you get, but it responds quite quickly to antibiotic therapy. Powassan virus is the one that you've been seeing a lot in the news lately. Okay. So Powassan virus was first recognized, as I mentioned earlier, from a child that died from it in Powassan, Ontario in 1958. Okay. Now, classic Powassan virus was not very common. It's transmitted by Ixodes cookii, which you could call a woodchuck or skunk tick. It will feed on humans. We get about like 3 at the experiment station every year. So it's not real common, but it occurs. A few more incidences of tick bite with Ixodes cookii in more northern New England than here, but it happens. So cases weren't very abundant, but it turns out that a deer tick virus was described in our black-legged tick. Turns out it's Powassan virus. They're slightly, very slight different strain. They're both Powassan virus, so they call them lineage 1, lineage 2. And with that, we're starting to see a steady increase in the number of cases. But it's still small. Nationally, we're still talking between 8 to 12 cases a year.
Same symptoms?
Fever? We had our first Connecticut case here. It was in a baby. You can look up the story in the Hartford Current. But it was a case where he's a hunter, he came back, he brought the ticks back with him, one of them bit the child, and the child came down with Powassan. Okay? Our ticks, the infection rate is roughly around 2% in our adult deer ticks with a Powassan virus. Now, it's probably a lot like West Nile in that most people that get Powassan probably have no symptoms. Most people that get West Nile virus have no symptoms. Okay? But risk goes up the older you get, too, as well. So the Powassan virus can infect the central nervous system. It can cause encephalitis, which is inflammation of the brain, meningitis, which is inflammation of the membranes around the brain, fever, headache, vomiting, weakness, some paralysis. It can progress to full meningoencephalitis with confusion, loss of coordination, speech difficulty, and seizures. And it has about a 10% fatality rate in those that actually develop the severe form of Powassan virus encephalitis. And those that survive can have permanent neurologic symptoms like recurring headaches, muscle wasting, memory problems, things like that. So it's not a pleasant virus, but again, you know, it's one of these cases that, you know, some people will be severely infected, some people may never know they had it.
On your earlier slide, you said this one goes immediately.
15 to 20 minutes. 15 to 20 minutes, yes. Yeah. Well, the others, you have a time lag. You have a time lag. Tick checks are important. Won't help you much with this one. Okay? So for those for you for Lyme, I know we're running a little over, but if you look at... Here's the Lyme disease cases by town in Connecticut in 2006. You can say it's pretty uniform across the state. You're at risk almost anywhere. Early infections characterized by the expanding red rash occurs in 60 to 80% of infected individuals. The rash is a slowly expanding rash. It's not the quarter-sized tick, you know, redness from the tick bite itself. Okay, and it resolves on its own in about 4 weeks if you don't do anything. It'll go away. Okay. It may clear in the center, but it's usually uniform. The classic bullseye appearance is actually only occurs in about 15% of the rashes. So don't expect that classic airy bullseye kind of appearance on every single rash that occurs. So you got that early localized infection. The rash, I said, appears anywhere from 3 days to a month after the bite. Tick bite, the average is about 7 to 9 days. Okay. Here is just some other examples of the Lyme rash. So its shape can vary depending on where in the anatomy the tick bite was. If it was the tick bit you in the head, you may not even notice the rash at all. If you're single and it's on your back, unless you're checking yourself in the mirror, you may also miss it. Okay? It doesn't itch, very rarely itchy, usually maybe warm to the touch, it doesn't have much sensation to it. Okay, so it's easy to miss. Okay, so Lyme spirochetes, after the tick bite, they spread in the skin. That's what's causing that rash, okay, as it spreads in the skin. And then it's in a very brief period, it spread through the blood to your other body tissues, particularly joint tissue and nervous tissue. But it's in the blood very transiently. I mean, it's a very short period, okay? So that's why you can't test directly for the spirochetes. They're there and they're gone. Okay, and then of course these early stages, you'll have your chills, fever, fatigue, headache, and so forth. About 15% of those people will have, besides their primary rash, will have multiple rashes. Okay, again, as that spirochete spreads through the skin tissues. And of course, late Lyme disease, you got your main manifestation, of course, is the arthritis, which occurs roughly in half of people, mainly the large joints. 10% of people will develop some form of neurologic Lyme disease. Bell's palsy is the most common symptom, which is paralysis of your facial muscles. But you also, as it gets into your central nervous system, you can have headaches, stiff neck. You can also have, you know, numbness in your extremities, changes in mood, cognitive impairment. And about 5 to 8% of people can have heart block. And there have been a couple of deaths caused simply due to heart baths. So Lyme disease is not considered generally a fatal disease, but those are the rare exceptions. But it can be quite debilitating. Okay. So if you look at your risk by age, nationally, the highest age risk is children, which corresponds with those that information that came from that survey when I showed you about the risk, when 47% of the questionnaires returned indicated that was the activity, was in children. 20 years old, it's the lowest risk, and then increases through the middle age years. So why is it so low in the people that are in their 20s? Game Boy, PlayStation, yes, no. Yeah, I'm just saying, yeah. So in other words, it kind of corresponds, think about gardening and yard work was a high-risk activity, so as people start acquiring homes, buying homes, you know, and start doing that kind of yard work and things like that, that increases your risk. Interesting, the Connecticut statistics, you've seen, this shows a shift here, kind of declines here nationally through the senior years, but actually they had, in 2015, it seemed to be heading up for the upper end. For those in their 60s and 70s. You know. So the testing, the standard testing is a two-tiered antibody testing. So the first test is an ELISA test, the enzyme-linked immunoassay. It's sensitive but not specific. So if that is negative, they won't do any further testing. But if it's positive, it could also be a cross-reaction with a number of other things. So it's not that specific to Lyme. So then the standard is to do a Western immunoblot, which is much more specific, to see whether it's actually Lyme that gave you a positive ELISA test. Okay. There is a new ELISA test using a different C6 peptide antigen, which seems to be actually more sensitive and specific. So some doctors are cutting the test off right at that point and not doing a Western blot if they use the C6 peptide in the ELISA. The biggest issue with the testing is that it's an antibody test. It takes several weeks to develop a titer or level of the antibodies that can be detected by the test. So you can have all the classic symptoms of Lyme, fatigue and a headache, and you feel lousy, and you got a rash. That's a clinical diagnosis. Okay, you should be treated on that basis. But you will have a negative test because it takes 4 to 6 weeks for your antibody levels to get high enough to be detected by the test. That's one of the biggest problems. So your first antibody that's produced in a new infection or your IgM antibodies, they develop in 2 to 4 weeks. As you see here, they peak in 6 to 8 weeks, and then they go away. And then your IgG antibodies develop in 4 to 8 weeks, peak in 4 to 6 months, and can last for quite a long time. So you can have, titers can persist for years, so you can have a positive Lyme test for a while after that. So generally at that point you'll want to do an IgM, IgG test. IgM shows up on the initial or first infection.
You get your antibiotic based on the symptoms.
Correct.
Will you never develop antibodies?
That's possible. Mm-hmm. If you catch it early enough, you will abort the infection process and you will never develop a positive antibody test. So if you get, if let's say you go out, you have a Lyme rash, it shows up, say, within a week, not one of the delayed ones, but with the average is a week for most people, a week after your tick bite, whether you knew it or not, but particularly if you knew you had a tick bite, so you got the timing down right, and you get treated right away, okay, then there's no point, really, probably, in doing a Lyme test, or at least be prepared for a negative test.
So then I find a tick, shall I have the tick treated? Immediately?
I mean treated.
Testing.
I mean tested.
Yeah, tested.
Well, you can. I mean, we do. We test. We get about 3,000 ticks a year. This past year has been actually a nightmare. Simply because we were well, we get about 3,000 a year. We hit 3,000 even before the summer hit. And the reason for that was is because of the mild winter. Now, remember what I said about the adult ticks? They emerge in the fall. They're not active in the cold winter months. And then the carryover population becomes active in the spring. Okay, well, we never really had much of a winter. So we were getting adult ticks coming into the tick testing lab almost all winter long, when normally we don't hardly see any. And so it was just crazy. And the population was up. It was a big tick year for the adults. So, you know, so it was a mild winter. So anyway, okay?
Great. So you have all those classic symptoms.
Well, I mean, that's a discussion. I can't say. Yeah, that's a discussion you have to have with your physician. I can't make a clinical call. I can give you some generalities, but I'm an entomologist, not an MD.
Can I ask one?
Huh?
Can we just have two more questions, because I have to clear up this room and the library closes at 5 o'clock.
Once you get it completely, like, full-blown Lyme, it's one of those diseases like herpes that stays in your system forever, and it can keep recurring, right?
It's an area of a lot of controversy. So I think in most people that if you once they get treated, even later Lyme disease, the treatment can be successful. There can be some longer term effects that takes longer to recover. The real controversy lies is whether or not there's so-called chronic Lyme or post-Lyme syndrome. So is it triggering conditions that are not treated by antibiotics, or is it basically a waste of treating, you know, because antibiotics are not safe under long-term thing. So is there actually persistent infection? And so there's a lot of, that's where the controversy really lies. I think in most people, the antibiotics clear the infection, but that doesn't mean you'll have some other long-term immune type based or some other kind of issues with it. So the early diagnosis and treatment is really important. Basically, the male, for most ticks, the females will actually, the males will be actually on the host animal.
Excuse me.
The host, basically, so when the female tick attaches onto its host, the male tick will then attach to the female tick. And so a hunter will see the female ticks will be attached to the deer. The male ticks will just simply be running around on that deer looking for females. They don't drop off, you know, they'll just keep looking for more females. And actually, when I've examined deer, it's very, very rare to find a female tick without a male tick attached. Okay? And actually, a male, our deer tick will actually mate off host. Most ticks will not mate off host. They can mate off host. But it still requires a male to stimulate that final engorgement. So you actually do have to have a male tick present for that female to complete engorgement.
Okay.
off of the deer.
So there's an injection from the male to the female?
Yeah. So basically the male transfers the sperm to his mouth parts and then he inserts them in the female.
So on that note, thank you again.
I mean, I have a small education block that I use with a larva, nymph, and the adults embedded, so it to show you what the actual size is, I find it very useful because it's a clear block. I can actually show what it's like against the skin in terms of the actual size. So.